see you. They're pretty nice. They're pretty nice.
continue with our worship, knowing that our God has loved us and forgiven us and brings us into his presence.
Let me not hear again the voice of the Lord. in the name of other gods, that same prophet shall die.
Thank you, Nicole. Please rise for our gospel. For those who wish to open up the Bibles in front of them, you can find this on page 836. The gospel lesson comes from the first chapter of the Gospel according to St. Mark, beginning with the 21st verse. They went into Capernaum, and immediately on the Sabbath, Jesus entered the synagogue and was teaching. And they were astonished at his teaching, for he taught them as one who had authority, not as scribes. And immediately there was in their synagogue a man with an unclean spirit. And he cried out, "What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." But Jesus rebuked him, saying, "Be silent and come out of him." And the unclean spirit, convulsing him and crying out with a loud voice, came out of him. They were all amazed, so that they questioned among themselves, saying, "What is this? A new teaching with authority. He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him." And at once his fame spread everywhere throughout all the surrounding region of Galilee. This is the gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. We have the joy of knowing who God is, the one shown as Creator, Redeemer, and Empowerer, Father, Son, and Spirit. And assuming I can clear my throat enough to say this, so. Fortunately, they're not my words, but the words that the Church has proclaimed for two millennia, the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. For those who would like to take notes during the sermon, we're about to sing, and then we'll be having a sermon. There are some sermon outlines out in the foyer. Feel free to grab those. And also, welcome to our pastor brothers who have joined us this morning for worship. We join together to sing.
Across the pages of time, he
God, you speak, and we oftentimes keep walking. Lord God, we can justify so many things in our minds. But we ask you, God, that you would convict us, that you would shape us, and that we would follow you, not because we have it figured out, but because we know that you are the one who has planned all things. In your name. Amen. Howdy. So, rumor has it that this is the year 2024. I don't know. I can't even figure out what day of the week it is half the time anymore. It's been very, very busy. The lead pastor role is a very, very busy job. But fortunately, I've got a lot of other people helping to keep me on track. So I've been very fortunate. But this thing is that I hear that this is an election year. I feel like the last 8 years have all felt like election years, so I don't even know anymore. But one of the things that I find fascinating is how many times that there are people that keep telling us, you see, I told you I was right. See, it's fascinating that people that want to be in some sort of leadership or control or determination, they have a habit of being able to say, all these things are going wrong. And then when one or two of them actually turn out to be true, then they can come back and say, you see, I told you. Have you ever had that one person in your life? No matter what you tell them about, it's always going to be bad and wrong, and then that way they can come in later and say, see, I told you this was going to go wrong. And the thing is that we seem to have a lot of people in the world today that they just know how to just keep talking, and then eventually something will end up being right. And then they'll be like, see, I told you. But I think that in many ways, we are just wishing and hoping that we could have those who could gather our attention and lead us, like those in the times past, like those like Charlton Heston playing Moses in the Ten Commandments. Let's be honest. Like, so I didn't grow up in the time when the movie first came out. Yes, I am in my 40s. No, for all of you youngins, that does not make me that old. Okay, but I did grow up in the time when ABC would play the Ten Commandments every single year. And my mom would put it on the calendar. Like, we actually had a physical calendar. It wasn't just on the phone. And she'd put on there, Moses, okay? And there you go. And with it, though, is I think for a while there she forgot that the actor's name was Charlton Heston, and every time she'd see him, it was like, Moses. But with it, though, is that he always seemed to have, there were these two phrases that always stood out. And it was Moses coming up and saying, let my people go. That, and you can rip it from my cold dead hands, which apparently is not from the movie, is what I've heard. But the thing is that somebody being strong and loud has in many ways turned into our minds as the idea of having authority. Is a person strong enough? Are they loud enough? And are they going to get your attention? But in reality, authority is not about that demeanor. Authority is about something that is deeper, something that we end up asking in regard to who it is that sends the person to do that work. Now, the thing about Moses coming to the people of God is that it was more than just Moses saying, I'm going to pull you out of Egypt, and we're going to go off and find the promised land. I mean, that would be a wonderful thing no matter what. If somebody tells you that there is something to look forward to, of course, it'd be great to listen. But here's the harder part. Moses also had to tell the people the ways in which they were wrong. And that's the harder part about what it was to lead as a prophet, is that not only did Moses have to be honest with the people about the ways in which they were misguided, but even Moses himself. Moses was not perfect by any means. And the times whenever Moses had messed up badly, he had to be willing to let God say, you are also a sinner in my eyes. Which, let's be honest, in our world today, nobody gets brownie points for saying that in any form of leadership. But with that is being able to say not just, are you willing to be honest and true with the people around you, but but are they willing to hear you with what you have to say? You see, how do we know if the prophet is actually from God? It says in Deuteronomy, when a prophet speaks in the name of the Lord, if the word does not come to pass or come true, that is a word that the Lord has not spoken. Isn't that strange? How do we know whether to believe what they say is going to happen? Do we just wait and see? It's sort of like whenever growing up, my sister and I would be sitting there with my mom and we'd be at the red light. And my sister always had this little game where she would be staring at the light and she'd go, green. And it's like, oh, you know, the light turned green. And she'd be like, it's like that somehow she just needed the timing. It's like, did she say green? And yeah, sometimes she was right. And then sometimes she'd say it 3, 4, or 5 times. And then finally it would actually turn green. And is that what it feels like about the prophet? Are we just, well, let's just see if whatever they said happens to be right. Okay, great, you were right. Oh, too bad, you were not. And the reality is that it's more than just trying to say, let's just wait and see. But it's also looking to where the person is here and now. And there are some things that hopefully you should typically hear from me in any good sermon. One, I'm going to make fun of myself at some point. Two, I'm going to reference something to do with some sort of Transformers or something recent that the youngins might know. And three, hopefully I should always bring it back to Jesus. Today, let's make sure we bring it back to Jesus. See, in our gospel, we see Jesus coming in and teaching with authority. I know that a lot of times we can imagine, how must Jesus have spoken? How must he have presented himself? But it wasn't about making sure that he was some amazing public speaker. It was what it was that he was saying to the people. Instead of just trying to say things that people were expecting or what they were comfortable with, it was that he was taking what they knew to be true about God, but connecting it in ways that they needed to hear. That's a harder piece to deal with. And let's be honest, we can sometimes kind of put a wall up in front of, we can ignore people, right? It's easy to ignore people sometimes. The interesting part, though, is when God finds a way to still get our attention. And what happens at that moment in time? Someone comes in and has an unclean spirit, some sort of a demon. And I know that there are discussions about whether or not it could have been epilepsy or something else like that. Fair discussion. The point being, though, is that they came to Jesus and needed his help. Now, did Jesus pause this person and say, listen, it's the Sabbath, okay? I'm really not supposed to be helping you out today. You see all these people around? They wouldn't really feel comfortable if I did that. So I'm going to need you to come back with your unclean spirit tomorrow, okay? We could, maybe 9 a.m. And I could schedule you with your demon for 9 a.m. tomorrow. Would that be okay? Not only did Jesus stop what he's doing and deal with it right then and there, but he also had the authority to actually do it. I think that's the piece that we oftentimes lose sight on with the people we're meant to listen to. Is being able to say, are you willing to be honest with us and not just say what you think we want to hear? The scribes can come up with all sorts of beautiful sayings and wonderful lectures and everything else. I mean, I occasionally try to throw in a Greek word from time to time. I just hope that makes me sound really, really smart. Maybe even some Hebrew. But the reality is that the people themselves needed to hear what God needed for them, not just what someone made them feel good about. That is far easier said than done. You see, it's not just asking about where we're going to be led, but also about where we're starting. And I think that's something that we, general. I also mean Christ's memorial. I think that's something that we have to pause and take accounting for. See, we can oftentimes get so caught up in thinking about all the future ideas and things that we want to get done in the world and how great things might someday be. But what about us right here and now? Are we willing to pause and actually listen and say, God, what is it that you need me to hear right now? Where do I need to grow and change? What is it that you need to be doing in my life right here and now? And frankly, if I as a pastor can't do that with you, then I really shouldn't be here. And then more than that, is to be willing to say, what is it that we feel that God's Spirit would actually lead us to work? Not trying to figure out, like, okay, what did that fancy group down the road, what is it that they figured out, what is it that they wanted? But instead, just be willing to say, what is it that God's calling us to do right here, right now, at this moment? Whom are we supposed to be helping? Where is it that we're being called? Third, is to be able to trust God to accomplish these things. Not looking to ourselves, not trying to figure it out, how am I going to be powerful enough to make this happen? But instead, how am I following God so that He's the one accomplishing it? Not in spite of us, but hopefully through us. Is there something that you've been avoiding? Is there something that you genuinely believe you need to actually listen to? Not waiting for someone to give you some grandiose idea or plan out there, but rather starting with you. Because at the end of the day, it's meant to be looking for God's goals, not ours. So I have three questions that I want to make sure that I pose to you. Number one. Does what we say and do ring true with God's word? Not does it sound like a good idea to me. Not does it sound like something that, you know, I wish would happen or would make me feel good. No. Right here, right now, does this actually sound like what God would want to hear? Number two. Are we focused on doing what God desires of us? See, that piece there is that instead of spending our time saying, what are my goals, what is it that I want, at this point, God has something for you. Is that what you're willing to pursue? But as scary as it is, it also brings us to number three. Is God doing His work in us, with us, through us, rather than around us? Because that's the thing about God. God can and does do His work. God can and does do His will. Are we willing to be the ones that He does it? Fair questions, I hope. And by the way, totally my fault the slides are not up there. I forgot to put them in the folder the way I was supposed to. I know. If you'd like to catch up with them, they're printed for you out in the foyer. I'll fix it for next week. My bad. With that, please rise for prayer. This morning, we want to be sure to bring Aaron's friend Lindsay for prayer. Going through cancer, even in the midst of raising her family. We wish to be able to remember Donna's son, Tyler, as he is healing from a foot injury before his special ops training. Also for her friend going through ALS. Remembering Richard as he heals from surgery. Mary Key as she is dealing with a pinched nerve. And Patty Wolf's friend, Melissa, going through issues with her eyesight at this time. Let's pray. Lord God, we are oftentimes seeking someone to listen to, some direction in which to go. But God, we ask that you would continue to remind us that we and those we follow should always be willing to hear what you need us to hear, not just what we wish we could hear. And Lord God, show us the directions that fit what you have guided us, not our plans, but yours. And Lord, as we do so, give us the trust and the faith that you will accomplish your goals, that you do have your plans in mind, and that you are powerful enough to do that, so that we would trust you to do it in us, through us, instead of just hoping that you'll find some way of doing it around us. Lord, in your mercy, Lord God, we know and trust that you are continuing to love and to guide and to be with us. Lord, we ask that you would continue to comfort and strengthen those who are in need. We ask that you be with Lindsay in this time of cancer, even with her family as well. We pray for Donna's friend dealing with ALS, as well as asking for healing for Tyler so that he'll be ready for this exam. Lord God, we pray for Richard in continued healing from surgery, for Mary in the midst of the issues of pain with this nerve. Lord God, for Melissa dealing with issues with her eyesight and hoping and praying that the treatment goes well. Lord God, we pray for Charles, Clara, Sue Ford, Marge, Gary, Don, Kristen, Bill, Laura, Zachary, Posey, Carolyn, Sarah. Lord God, for so many that struggle in different ways, whether physically or mentally or emotionally or spiritually, Lord God, we ask that you would move us to help as we can. Bless the hands and the abilities of those who can do more than we can. And Lord God, even beyond all of us, we ask that you would bring healing and peace, whether in this world or in the next. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For all of those who are unable to join us because they are homebound, Estella, Billy, Rosemary, Donna, Joanne, Claire, Mildred, Skip, Shirley Smith, those who are doing work in different ways throughout the community, including Tyler and Shaolin, and all of those in our military, those who serve, whether EMT or fire or police or sheriffs or whomever, Lord God, all of those who work with Ed and beyond. And Lord, we ask that you bless all of those in missions in various places, including Kristen and all of those that we sponsor, as well as those beyond that realm. Lord God, we ask that you would continue to move and guide them, that they would seek your will, and that for the times whenever they stumble, that they would come to you in humility, that you would lift them and guide them. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For this and for all things, God, thank you for hearing us and leading us and guiding us, even as you have taught us, including how to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. We have switched to the green cards. We are going to be updating them shortly, because, hey, we're almost done with this particular round. But we ask that everybody would fill them out, whether member or visitor guest. We thank you. Just be sure to put notes on there about your prayer requests, as well as anything that you need to communicate with us. Let us know. But also, we want to make sure that we have the opportunity to bring our offerings to the Lord. For those of you joining us online, if you wish to do so through our website, many of us just have an automatic withdrawal. It's just a whole lot easier on that account. But more than anything, if you haven't had the opportunity to sign up for being involved in ministries here or some of our small groups, please let us know. We'd love to get you involved. With that, we bring our offerings unto the Lord. Thank you. in this meal, because it is a meal that brings us together, being one that Christ himself instituted for us. See, the night when our Lord Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread that was there at the Passover meal, and he gave thanks, and he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat of it. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way also, after supper, he took the cup. When he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Take and drink of it. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." This bread, this wine, they are still bread and wine. But in the midst of this meal, we are proclaiming what it is that Christ has proclaimed to us, that his crucifixion, his body and blood on the cross, bring us salvation. So for those who believe that Christ Jesus has accomplished everything for your salvation, and those who believe his presence to be here affirming our forgiveness and our place at his table, we invite you to come forward and to receive this with us. For those who need gluten-free, we have that available on the side. For those who need alcohol-free, it is clear in the center of the tray. Let nothing keep you from the table of our Lord. The peace of the Lord be with you always. You may be seated.
The strength of peace on your promise.
Please rise. May the body and blood of Christ Jesus bless and keep you as you go out into the world, seek his will, and ask him to lead and guide you now and always. Amen. How about we sing? Give you his peace. Amen. Have a great week, everyone.